Welcome back, folks. Dow right now is up 304. NASDAQ is up 166. S&Ps are up 52. Let's go over to our man, Mr. Jason Path, as we do every Tuesday and Thursday, folks, at quarter past the hour. Jason, what's going on, brother?
Not much, Tom. How are you, man?
Good, man. Good. So we're gonna be talking some gas, some oil, some rates, some currencies, and let's kick it off with the gas market.
Yeah, huge move up today. Now, we did have a pipeline explosion overnight in Kentucky, which fueled some of this move. But as you know, I've been calling gas higher now for a few weeks. It's really a tale of two different fuels between oil and gas right now. Gas is going to benefit, as we've discussed, from the production declines that we're going to see given the dynamics in the oil market. I like 250 on gas futures as we cross into June, which we still have some headroom here, about 40 cents on the futures.
Yeah, that's a good move, right? We're around 179 right now?
No, I'm at 210 on the front months right now.
Sorry, man. Okay, cool.
Hey, no worries, man. No, yeah, we had a huge move up today given the pipeline explosion last night. It's been up steadily since the end of the week last week, so. You know, now as things incrementally start to open up a little bit
on the demand side, I see.
Yeah, we're gonna continue. I really believe we're gonna continue to see sharp moves up. I think gas got disproportionately hit when everything started locking down. You know, even though we're at home, we still got to heat and cool. It's been cool in the Northeast. Yeah, I'm out in the Northeast, man. I got my V-neck on today. It's gonna get up to 50. We're gonna get down in the 30s overnight, so to speak.
And really?
It's really hot. Yeah, it's cold up there, man. As you know, in the Northeast this time of year, normally we're not running anything, right? It's very mild. We don't need to heat or cool. Heating degree days are off the chart right now, near record levels for this time of year. I still like gas higher. I think this is a pretty solid play. We were talking about 155 3 weeks ago. We're at 210 and rising today.
Now, you talk about deviant, right? That's about as deviant as you get. Gas has been going down forever. All of a sudden, the oil goes to zero. We go negative, and gas is going positive. You got to love it. So what do you think about this oil move out here today?
Yeah, it's crazy. Extremely speculative move. You talked about the volume and some other issues. It's just, to me, this market is radioactive. I'm not active in oil right now at all. You know, I like a short soon. I think that's on my radar. But, you know, to me, if you're going long oil here, if you've been long, I was thinking this morning, it's like a Wizard of Oz move. It feels good because everything's opening back up and people are going to be in their cars. But, if somebody wants to go long oil right now, my two words for you, like jet fuel, right? I mean, we're still not flying. Jet fuel is a material double-digit percentage of oil consumption in this country.
Seriously, yeah.
And folks, to me, the airplanes are a good indication of what we still have ahead of us. There's nothing in our lockdown that impacted air traffic, right? You could still get on a plane. You could still fly.
Right.
We all chose not to. It went down by 95%. Buffett's now out of airlines.
Yep.
But there was nothing that the government did to limit our jet travel, and we just chose not to because we were scared about our health.
Well,
I don't think that's going to go away because we can now go to 7-Eleven.
I agree. Well, what you're saying, and folks, this is what I got out here in St. Petersburg the last few days, right? We could open, as a 25%, right? Well, guess what? A lot of them aren't opening, and people still aren't coming out. So that says quite a bit, man. Do you know what I mean?
It's I'm in Washington, D.C. I had a hard time finding a pizza place to deliver last night. The economic damage is far deeper and greater than any government regulation that we felt like, whether we agreed or disagreed. And I think we have a lot of pain. And again, I think the airlines are a good indication. But back to oil, right? That's still a supply and demand issue that's not going to reconcile, even though I may be able to get in my car and drive somewhere. We're still not flying. That's a double-digit percentage of oil consumption. It's not going to come back anytime soon.
Yeah, no doubt. And so let's get into the bond and the interest rate market. What are we thinking here?
Yeah, so, we learned yesterday, and of no surprise to anyone keeping score at home, the government's going to have to issue, close to $3 trillion over the next few months. It's just, it's hard to conceive of that much paper hitting the market. The tensions with China, last time we had these types of tensions with China, they slowed down their purchases of U.S. debt. I don't think, there's the conspiracy theories that they start to sell or flood the market. That's not going to happen. They're not going to hurt
themselves. No, because they hurt themselves, right.
Right. To the extent that they slow down purchases, I think that's possible. You know, but with that much paper hitting the market, you know, I think we got stretched, you know, on the 30-year. I think it went about as low as it could go structurally a few weeks back, and it's been slower to recover than the others. You know, we've talked about some other ratios we use, like copper, gold, et cetera. I think the yields have to snap back. We started to see that move, you know, which means the value of the paper goes down.
Yeah,
demand
and I think
is less, yields
that,
go up.
You know, we saw that, you know, folks, when the 10 went to 0.31 or 1%, the bottom line is that
right.
The mortgage market didn't follow it. Because what ended up happening is that the demand was so much for the mortgages that they could keep the rates higher. So I agree
right.
with you, man.
It's got to come back.
I think we saw that structure basically more than likely bottom out, which is pretty wild, man.
Yeah, so I think that's a trade where, you know, folks think equities go long from here, but there's still a lot of risk on the table. And I would certainly agree with that view. I'm not bullish equities from here. But, you know, yields, if equities do rocket higher from here, continue to go higher, you're gonna see yields go out. But I think you have some downside protection because I don't think yields could go much lower, even, you know, with the bottoming that we saw. I think they hit rock bottom structurally. So I think you have better downside protection than you do with equities if you go short paper here, but you're gonna still potentially enjoy the upside.
Yeah. Now I know, you know, we've been talking the euro. I mean, what happened in Germany today, folks, is that the German court turned around and is basically...
This is amazing.
Yeah, if you can explain it, because it's pretty wild, man, what's happening over there, right?
So when the ECB does easing, right, they have to get the participation of the other sovereign nations
yes.
in the euro to participate in that. What the German Constitutional Court said today was, unless the ECB can prove, basically to a standard that's not possible, that why we should, as a sovereign nation, participate in their program, we're dropping out within 90 days. The ECB cannot function without support of Germany. Like, that is the end of the EU as we know it.
Right.
There's no other court to appeal to. This is Germany taking a stand and saying, basically, you know, in 90 days, that's it. Like,
right.
we're not going to play this game. Merkel, you know, under the context of this, Merkel's been structurally supportive of the EU, but, you know, it's an issue in Germany. She's already said she's out of office for the next 12 to 18 months. It could be, you know, a lame duck session for her. Anything could happen, but, you know, I don't see how the ECU or ECB in Germany reconcile this. Don't forget, you've also got the political issues, folks wanting to leave for a different reason in Italy
sure.
and Spain. Britain's finally going to get their deal together and leave the EU. You know, we talked last week, you know, I think 30% downside on the euro is absolutely, you know, the next, you know,
no,
12 to 24.
Listen, I can see it. I mean, Germany, they, you know, the bottom line is that they had the explosion in, you know, inflation, what, you know, whether it's 80 years ago now. I can't see them changing, man. You know, it's
no.
Yeah, pretty amazing.
They're going to be stubborn about it, and it's going to be fascinating to watch it play out. But it's hard to see a peaceful resolution. Well, I mean, I shouldn't use the word peaceful here, but it's hard to see a resolution between the ECB and Germany that doesn't result in significant damage to
yeah.
the structure of the ECB.
No doubt. Well, listen, man, we appreciate the education. Look forward to speaking
yeah,
on Thursday.
Love it. Thanks, Tom. Enjoy the rest of the day, man.
Have a safe one. Stay right there, folks. Come right back.